wish there was something stronger in that water, but maybe later. Pardon me. On behalf of the Carnovale family, I would like to welcome you today for the remembrance service for Glenn. It is so comforting to see so many people here. He must have had a lot of friends. And I know he'd be very appreciative of your coming. To share some of the memories and give thanks for the good times in his life, that's what I think we're going to do today. There were two sides to Glenn. I've come to realise that in the last few years. There was the boisterous side, the larger-than-life character of some of us called him the big fella, the ox, or ox. I could never come to do that. I never called him anything else but Glenny. It was always Glenny. Then there was the private side he so loved to read his beloved Bible. For many hours each day and night, and often he sent text messages to his dear mum on which passages she might reflect on next time she picked up the Bible. His discovery of the inner peace it brought him culminated in discovering his true love of Jesus Christ, which was the only thing that superseded his love of his family. I trust that through the spiritual journey today, that we can share that love of Christ with Glenn, or at least be comforted by finding a small measure of peace that may guide us to rediscovering our own paths to our God, whoever it is, and whoever you think it is, and that it may mould our journeys in this life. In this holy place, this church, this truly beautiful house of God, even for such a short time, could be your opportunity to renew your conversation with God, accept his divine spirit, and at the same time honour Glenn by joining in the hymns, the psalms, the prayers and the acclamations. So let's not make this a sad occasion, but a tribute to Glenn. I could think of no other way to present the beginning of this service by the psalm Amazing Grace. And I could think of no other better way than to have it presented by the bagpipes. And so therefore, I hope you find this soul-searching and it warms your heart, and it warms my heart to see you all here in honour of my dear son, Glenn. Thank you.
Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with you.
My dear friends, we believe that all the ties of friendship and affection, which knit us as one throughout our lives, do not unravel in death. So today, this morning, we come together in the Sacred Heart Church to pray for our brother Glenn, that God may embrace him and receive him into his everlasting kingdom, that one day we may also join him there and enjoy each other's company for eternity. In the waters of baptism, Glenn died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory. And let us pray. O God, Almighty Father, our faith professes that your Son died and rose again. Mercifully grant that through this mystery, your servant Glenn, who has fallen asleep in Christ, may rejoice to rise again through him, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
So please be seated, and I invite our readers to come forward.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. The life and death of each of us has its influence on others. If we live, we live for the Lord. And if we die, we die for the Lord. So that alive or dead, we belong to the Lord. This explains why Christ both died and came to life. It was so that he might be Lord both to the dead and the living. We shall all have to stand before the judgment seat of God. As Scripture says, "By my life, it is the Lord who speaks. Every knee shall bend before me, and every tongue shall praise God." It is God, therefore, that each of us must give an account of himself. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
The Lord is my light and my help. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Before whom shall I shrink?
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
There is one thing I ask of the Lord, for this I long, to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to savor the sweetness of the Lord, to behold his temple.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
O Lord, hear my voice when I call. Have mercy and answer. It is your face, O Lord, that I seek. Hide not your face.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
I am sure I shall see the Lord's goodness in the land of the living. Hope in him, hold firm, and take heart. Hope in the Lord.
The Lord is my life, my salvation.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. We know that he who raised the Lord Jesus to life will raise us with Jesus in our turn, and put us by his side, and you with us. You see, all this is for your benefit, so that the more grace is multiplied among people, the more thanksgiving there will be to the glory of God. That is why there is no weakening on our part, and instead, though this outer man of ours may be falling into decay, the inner man is renewed day by day. Yes, the troubles which are soon over, though they weigh little, train us for the carrying of a weight of eternal glory, which is out of all proportion to them. And so we have no eyes for things that are visible, but only for things that are invisible. For visible things last only for a time, and the invisible things are eternal. For we know that when the tent that we live in on earth is folded up, there is a house built by God for us, an everlasting home not made by human hands in the heavens. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. So let us stand and greet the gospel together. Praise and honor to you, Lord Jesus Christ. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Whoever believes in me will not die forever. Praise and honor to you, Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord be with you and with your spirit. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the crowds, "All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I shall not turn away, because I have come from heaven, not to do my own will, but to do the will of the one who sent me. Now, the will of him who sent me is that I should lose nothing of all that he has given to me, and that I should raise it up on the last day. Yes, it is my Father's will that whoever sees the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and that I shall raise him up on the last day." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. And please be seated for a moment. My dear friends, how beautiful it is to watch shoots of young wheat swaying in the wind and dancing in the sun. But how strange it is the process by which these shoots come to be. First of all, the grains of wheat have to be buried in the cold earth, as in the tomb. Then they have to die. If they didn't die, no new life would come forth. But when they die, from the grave of old grains shoots a new wheat. Miraculously springing forth. In time, each of these shoots will produce a whole earful of new grains. It's an amazing paradox, life coming through death. The way of salvation is similar. It is Christ who tells us this. Just as the grain of wheat must die if it is to bear fruit, so there is a sense in which we must die if we are to live fully and fruitfully. We are like seeds dropped by the hand of God into the field of life. Under his watchful gaze, we break through the surface and open ourselves to the sun and the rain. But having opened ourselves to receive, we must also open ourselves to give. For to give is to live. Those who live for themselves will stagnate. But those who live for others and for God will grow and bear fruit. But to live for others means to die to self. Something that doesn't come easy, to human nature. Jesus not only told us about this, but he gave us an example. He died to all the forms of self-seeking, giving his life in our service. And when the actual moment of death arrived, he surrounded himself into God's hands. And God rescued him from the tomb and gave him new life. Thus, the hour of his humiliation became the hour of his glory. The hour of his death became the hour of his greatest fruitfulness. For it was his death that won eternal life to all of us. My dear friends, our brother Glenn was selfless in his love for his family and friends. He shared with them everything he had. I didn't know Glenn personally, but speaking with his father, Alan, and also hearing his introduction this morning, we know, and you probably know, how selfless he was. He was always prepared to walk the extra mile. And those who die to self will find the moment of actual death easy. The hour of death will become an hour of glory. It is by dying that we are born to eternal life. And we are confident that God, who brings forth wheat from the seeds buried in the heart of the earth, we rescue our brother Glenn from the power of death and bring him to fullness of life in heaven. So let us entrust Glenn to God's mercy and pray that he will embrace him and receive him into his everlasting kingdom.
Glenn's love for his family, his commitment to friends, and his support for those in need set an example for us all. Grant us the grace to follow in his ways and make the world a better place. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Blessed are we who are saddened by the loss of one whom we have loved. May our hope in the resurrection and the promise of eternal life bring us comfort and turn our sadness into joy. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Compassionate God, so often your ways are beyond our understanding. As we entrust Glenn to your care, strengthen our faith and trust in Christ. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer. God, giver of all life, we pray that you will hear our prayers for life and mercy through Christ our Lord. Amen. So now let us stand and pray together the prayer which Jesus himself taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. And please be seated. And now I would like to invite Philip, Timothy, and Paul to share some memories of them.
Thank you. Can everyone hear me?
Okay.
Hello everyone, for those that don't know me, my name's Phil, and
Sorry, I'm his brother Steve.
Sorry, can you just read a bit for me?
Phil has asked me to stand here for Superstar on stage today for moral support, as I give him what is undoubtedly the hardest speech he has ever had to give.
Okay, I'll take it from here. Thanks, mate. Oh.
Deep breath, mate.
Gwen's been my best friend my entire life. I'm not sure. Not sure when we first met, but there's a Super 8 home movie my parents have at my fourth birthday party. Yeah. And Gwen's in that film. Gwen's 3.5 months younger than me, so he must have been 3 years, 8.5 months old at that time. We already knew each other. When most people who don't know Gwen see him for the first time, they usually stare a bit, keep their distance due to the intimidating stature and appearance of him. But once they met him, started talking to them, they quickly realised he was both a gentleman and a sweetheart. He loved animals. The last time we met at Carnovale Beach car park, which is where we'd usually meet. Up the north end, overlooking Carnovale Basin.
Take it easy, mate. I'll help you. Okay, I'll do it. Where is it? Did you finish?
Here?
Okay.
You typed it up. That's good. I would never have read your writing. When most people who don't know Glenn see him for the first time, they usually stare a bit and keep their distance due to his intimidating nature and appearance. But once they met him and he started talking to them, they quickly realised that he was both a gentleman and a sweetheart. He loved animals, and last time we met up on Carnovale Beach car park, which is where we would usually meet. Up the north end overlooking Carnovale Basin, we would usually meet up and have a catch up while watching the waves, the surfers and the sunset. The last time we met up there, we got out of the cars and Glenn immediately noticed a lady at one end of the tables with two little Papillon dogs, one black and one white, the other tan and white. Okay. When Glenn was younger, the family had two Papillon dogs exactly the same colours. Glenn said, "Papillons, I've got to go over there and have a chat." I was expecting him to spend about 10 minutes or so talking and stroking the dogs, but he was there for a full hour. When he eventually dragged himself away from them, he said, "Sorry, Phil, I didn't mean to ignore you, but the Papillons, you can't compete." I added that bit. It needed a little bit. When he said that, his eyes lit up and he was just like a little kid again, super excited. I just laughed and laughed. It was great seeing him like that. He told me that the owner said the dogs were both rescued and that the tan and white never let strangers stroke him. He always bites them. However, Glenn had no such reaction. He patted, I think the dog may have been intimidated. And he stroked both dogs the whole time. He told the owner, "I used to have Papillons. You just have to be really gentle with them. If a dog was ever going to bite a stranger trying to pat it, I imagine someone looking like the way Glenn does would be on top of the list." Glenn was a classic case of don't judge a book by its cover. A lifelong friendship obviously has its ups and downs. We didn't always get along, but we would occasionally get into arguments and butt heads. It wasn't all beer and Skittles. He struggled constantly with his demons through most of his life and would seek relief by sometimes self-medicating with alcohol. It is something that was extremely painful for his family and close friends to watch. But knowing he was going through so much emotional and mental pain, the alcohol was not only not helping him, but turning him to someone else. I could see it warped his personality for a time. I lost my best mate. The old personality was gone and it just became too painful to be around him. It always been a rule I lived by never to leave a man behind. I never gave up on him. I did everything in my power to let him know I was always in his corner and he was not alone. So did his family and many of his other friends. It took many years and loss of perseverance, but eventually he turned his life around. It was then he realised what the most important life was in life, and that is the relationship you have with your family and friends. He also realised that drinking damages those relationships. We had many conversations during which he said deeply regretted many of his life's choices and the years he felt he had wasted, as well as the people he had loved and had hurt. He was also ashamed about a lot of his behaviour over the years due to it. Glenn did a lot of work on himself after that. He was always a very spiritual person. Having been raised a Roman Catholic, he started really getting into reading the Bible, attending church and Bible study groups. He also shared his learnings and insights from his Bible readings with others and made his mission to help people wherever he could. He once told me a story about seeing an old lady struggling to carry her shopping bags to her car. He went over and offered to carry them for her. He chatted with her while carrying her shopping bags. After loading the shopping bags in her car, she said, "You know, you're the first person I've ever talked to in 3 weeks." I thought he was going to say, "This is not my car." But Glenn's Bible readings were a major catalyst for him turning his life around. Before COVID hit, Glenn was volunteering his time down in Manly to serve food to the homeless people and sit and talk at length with them, giving them positive human contact and letting them know they weren't alone, that people cared. He also told me many times his main goal was to repair the relationship in his family and be the linchpin that holds his family together. He was instrumental. Another thing I've always enjoyed was his great sense of humour. I've never laughed so hard or so much as I have with Glenn. No matter what we were doing, we'd always make each other laugh. Since he has been leading by example, he has also inspired me to work on being a better human being. When Glenn made friends, he generally made friends for life. As you can see by looking around you today, his turnout. As I look at you all, I can see the Northern Beaches has lost a favourite son. I've always believed that death is not the end. I believe that in fullness of time we meet up again, and with everyone we love in this life, we'll find them on the other side. Consequently, I didn't come here today to say goodbye. I came to say, I'll see you a little bit further down the road, brother. He was instrumental in convincing me to move back to the Northern Beaches after 20 years in Queensland and be closer to my parents. He said, "You'll never get this time back. If something happens to them and you're in Queensland, you'll never forgive yourself for losing this opportunity and squandering those precious years with them." He was 100% right about that. Thank you, mate. Is that it? All right.
There you go.
Those who don't know me, I'm Glenn's little brother, Tim. I'd like to start by thanking everybody for coming. I know it'd mean a lot to him, as it does us, his family. I'd like to also thank everybody who's reached out the last few weeks and lent their support. I'd all the messages, the calls, the flowers. Little brother. It's handwritten and his writing's not the easiest thing to read, so I'll do my best. I told him you should have typed it up. No. Okay, let's have a look. So we'd like to thank everybody that's reached out these last few weeks and lent their support. All the messages, calls and flowers truly means everything to us. To know how much of an impact Len has made in everyone's lives. My big brother, everyone's big brother, the Ox, a larger than life character. I'm sure he's most remembered for his size, big personality, protective nature, and loyalty, and just being the Ox. To me, simply just as my big brother, and that was always enough. Most important things to Glenn, friends and family. He loved his family very much. Loyalty was very important. He was a very loyal person. So many people here today are a good sign of that. Family gatherings were what he looked most forward to. When we all get together, nothing would make him happier than seeing his family together. He loved being a big brother, a son, and most of all, an uncle. He loved William, little Willie, his nephew, so much.
Do we have another day? Quick history.
A quick history, early years. Born and bred on the northern beaches, grew up in Carnovale, went here to Sacred Heart for primary school and Martin Maria in Warriewood for high school. My memories of our childhood together were cricket, footy in the park, basketball on the front lawn with all the kids in the neighbourhood, every moment we got till the sun went down. We were all very competitive with each other. Glenn felt it his job to teach us how to play hard and fair, mostly hard. But most importantly, never give up. I think that's where I really learnt sports. I'm sure that's where my competitiveness started. Three of us, always competing at everything together. Glenn knew if we could take it from him, we could take it from anybody. It was his job to prepare us. Family holidays every year to his favourite place on earth, Yarrawonga. He loved the relaxing lifestyle, fishing, sitting around the fire of a night. But most importantly, I think he loved being around his whole family in the one place. Later years at DY, he lived in a unit that he helped build with my father, a place he had a very special bond with, a very special connection, as that's where my grandparents lived. And he was very close with them. I like to think that he's up there in heaven, in a place like Yarrawonga, with my grandparents, having a good laugh, catching up, telling stories, finally at peace. Finally, with his back not hurting, absolutely no pain at all. But also finding plenty of time to check the perimeters, making sure everybody feels safe. You have to wonder God's reaction when he hears the Ox for the first time say, "I think I'm going to go check the perimeters of heaven." My early memories, what I remember most from a young age, from him carrying my school bag home when I was in primary school, to letting all my friends, basically everybody I know in high school, that he was my big brother, to always keeping an eye on me, looking after me, making sure I feel safe, making sure I have nothing to worry about. I still remember people's reactions when they would find out that Glenn was my big brother. My feelings were always of being very proud. later on, coming to my basketball games, pacing up and down the sideline, giving death stares to anybody who got too close to me, to always offering his help with everything, with anything, at work or home, never saying no, never asking for anything in return. The last couple of weeks I've been reading a lot of prayers, trying to find a way to deal with it, anything that can help. Here's just a little one I found that I quite like. Dear Lord, I've lost somebody dear to me. I'm struggling with the overwhelming emotions. I ask that you fill me with the comfort and peace that only you can provide. I pray for you to lessen this burden as days pass by. Help me to find refuge in your presence, Lord. Fill me with the emptiness in me, with your love. I know that better days are coming because you are with me. Help me hold on to that hope, Lord, for I know your love can take away my sorrow. I pray for Glenn, who is now with you in heaven. May his soul find eternal rest as he is now at peace in your kingdom. This I ask through Christ our Lord. Amen. Funerals are a time to mourn, but also a time to celebrate a life. We're all here for different reasons, we're all here for different amounts of time. We wish we had longer, but it's important we remember the good times. Seeing so many people here really makes me think of the positive and long-lasting influence he's had on so many. Hopefully today we can all raise a glass, reflect on our favorite stories and times together. Thank you.
Okay. Well, I'm Glenn's little brother, Tim's big brother. Firstly, I would like to thank everyone that has come here today to celebrate my brother's life. We are truly grateful for all the support. Although his life was cut way too short, he did live a memorable life, one that was full of charisma and fun moments. And while we are deeply saddened by his sudden passing, we should also remember that this is a celebration of a wonderful life. I'm sure all of us have very fond memories of the big fella, and I look forward to trading stories with all of you after this service concludes. In the meantime, I've written a few words in honor of my brother. For many of you here today, Glenn was a great mate. For some of you, a lifelong friend. A larger-than-life character with an extremely big heart. Glenn had a protective quality, one that made all those around him feel safe. You just knew he always had your back. He was fearless, strong, dependable. Simply put, the ox. Glenn never believed in just dipping his toe in the water. He took everything he did to the absolute extreme. In the early days, it was bodybuilding, martial arts, and sport. These weren't just hobbies, they became obsessions. In the later years, his focus shifted more towards his religious faith. He loved reading his Bible, and he had reconnected with his love of playing music. But what both impressed and surprised me was his tireless ability and dedication in sending such detailed, insightful, and caring messages of hope to many of us. And if you ever saw his tiny broken phone and his huge hands, I still don't know how he managed it. It must have taken him hours. Those of us that had the privilege of seeing this softer but more serious side to Glenn saw a man who was devoted to something much bigger than himself. He had time for people. He had cast aside all judgment and become a generous human, evident in his regular volunteer work he did, helping feed the homeless at St. Matthew's Church soup kitchen in Manly. He had become a deep thinker who would passionately express his opinions without any fear of judgment. He was never one to sit on the fence. He trusted the courage of his convictions. He always had the confidence and the bravery to say and do what he thought was right. But to me, he was just my big brother. He was fiercely loyal, always ready to lay down his life for his family. And as a young kid, I absolutely idolized my big brother. He was the toughest, strongest person I knew, and he was just good at everything. But above all, he was always there to look after his brothers. I have so many memories of my brother as my protector. And one of my earliest memories that still remains with me today was back in high school. The year was 1990, 33 years ago. I was in year 9. Glenn was a couple of grades above in year 11. A group of 5 or 6 kids in my year had stolen some things from my school bag. When I approached them, I quickly found myself in trouble. Fortunately for me, one of my mates, I think it was Rob or Craig, might have been both, had alerted Glenn to the trouble that I was in, and he needed no invitation. He came bounding down this dirt rock wall that led down to the basketball courts where I was, with dust flying up and rocks giving way under each step. He ran to my defense. I still remember what he said to me 33 years on. "Don't worry, little bro, I've got this." I won't tell you what he said to my would-be attackers, but I've never seen so many kids go to water and scatter. I can confirm that all my stolen possessions were returned. No one ever stole from me again, and I had a very smooth run through my final years of high school with my own personal bodyguard. With Glenn, there was just no hesitation when it came to defending his family and his closest friends. He was just born to be a protector, and he wore that title like a badge of honor. I would often tell Glenn, "I don't need protecting. I can take care of myself." But he would always be quick to remind me, "Little brother, that is not your responsibility." He was and will always be his brother's keeper. Looking back, I always thought that with my big brother by my side, who could ever be against me? And just recently, I found a text message sent only a few weeks ago that read, "Little brother, with God on our side, who would be against us?" He was teaching me humility. I'll always love you, my big brother. And although your time was cut short, I'm thankful for the time we did have. And in conclusion, I really believe that my big brother must have received a call from God requesting his services. I know how committed he was to serving God, and as much as it would have been an incredibly difficult decision to leave his family and friends, this was just a higher calling. God may have needed to fortify the perimeters of heaven, and I know no better man for the job. Rest in peace, my big brother, and stay busy out there.
And I want to share some photo memories with Glenn.
Thank you. Hallelujah.
on behalf of the family, I would like to thank you once again for coming, and I hope you found this to be a very spiritual time. I would also like to thank Father Richard. Although I haven't known you for such a very long time, I truly find you inspiring, and I know you meant every word you said today. I felt like you were speaking directly to me. Thank you, Father. Thank you to Randy and Luke for the reading, and to Brett for the last minute stand-in. But I had him in mind all the time, I just didn't tell him. Thank you to Phil. I'm so pleased you had this, you had typed it out. It's so much easier to read. And to Tim, you never let me down. And Paul, such inspiring words. I'm very proud of all of you. Thank you to Andrew, the piper. He's doing such a lovely job with the bagpipes. And thank you to Chris Lee of Peninsula Funerals for organising such a respectful service. And it's much appreciated, Chris. And for the photo presentation, I appreciate that. And thank you again to all the others of you who have come, and the spirit in which you've come, and the strength you've given to my family today is immeasurable. And I trust you have time to join us afterwards at Pittwater in the distillery bar. And having seen those pictures of Glenn, I don't know when he had a picture without a drink in his hand, but then again, that was him. And as we, after Father's final address to us, there'll be the song Danny Boy, followed by Scotland the Brave. I could think of no other way of sending the guy out with that one. But when you hear the words Danny Boy, which hopefully will be the first verse by Eva Cassidy before the bagpipes, just change the words to Glennie Boy. Thank you.
So my dear friends, before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother Glenn. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. So please join me in the responses to the song of farewell. Saints of God, come to his aid. Come to meet him, angels of the Lord. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. May Christ, who called you, take you to himself. May the angels lead you to the Father's side. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. In other Christian funerals, we use the holy water, which reminds us about our baptism, when we were first joined with Christ, so that the end of our life may be also shared in Christ's glorious resurrection. We also use the incense, as the smoke rises from all our thoughts and prayers in front of God's throne. So let us stand for our final prayer. Into your hands, Father of mercy, we command our brother Glenn, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Glenn in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurance of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother Glenn forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come and welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you all, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So let us take our brother Glenn to his place of rest.
Thank you.